All right, we're in John chapter 11, starting in verse 32. It says, "Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, Where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, Behold how he loved him. And some of them said, Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, Take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, Said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his voice and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, Loose him and let him go. And so that's what I titled my message this morning, Loose him and let him go. Father, one more time, we come to you in prayer, and we thank you for your precious word and the reading of your word. And Lord, I pray that this morning we would gain great revelation, Lord, through what you're doing, Lord, through the gospel, through what you did in the giving of your precious son. Give us, Lord, understanding this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And so, you know, just to get a little bit of a geographical context of where we are, you can see that the it's kind of hard for you maybe to see, but the two bodies of water once again represent the little map that I often draw. At the top, the little blue one is the Sea of Galilee, and down here is the Dead Sea, and this little strip between is Israel. Over here to the right, we're about to pull some things up. You're going to see a place on the other side of the Jordan, and you're going to see two other locales over here on this side of the Jordan. And it's just kind of like to chronicle really where we are as far as for geographically in this story. I like to know these things, and I think it's important at some point in time for you as a Bible student to become concerned of it, just because you understand better as you read whenever you understand where you are. It's like I don't have to give you a whole lot of explanation when I tell you, hey, go down to the supermarket in Centerville and pick me up such and such. You might not even know exactly where, but you know where Centerville is, and so at least you have some context and some understanding on how to figure out where it is that you're going and what it is that I'm needing you to do. And so these are some of the bridges that we have to cross. We talked about that last Sunday night, that there's bridges that have to be crossed over. Culture, context, language, history, all these various things that make it more difficult for us to understand the scriptures. But so this is what ends up happening is that over here in Jerusalem, that's where the square is. You see the red square? Jesus was originally in Jerusalem for something called the Feast of Dedication. We're going to mention that a little bit this morning in the message. He was in Jerusalem for that feast. And then the Word of God says that he went back across the Jordan River, and that's where that little red spot that I just dropped down on you is, that to the original place where John the Baptist was originally baptizing. So at this time in this story of Jesus' life, John the Baptist is probably already, he's already been in prison, and so that's not the issue, but Jesus has gone back over there to this time frame, and so, to this place, and so that's what it is. He went from Jerusalem to this other place on the Jordan. But what we're going to see is that there's a little town that's right next to Jerusalem, and it's called Bethany. We're going to stay there just for a second, okay? This little place called Bethany is actually where the family of Lazarus was from. Now, I got to be honest, this is the first time that we're really introduced to this person, Lazarus, the character of the story. Many times, whenever I've talked to you about teaching the Bible and better understanding the Bible, one of the things that we've talked about many times is that there's different types of literature in the Bible. And one of the forms of literature literature is narrative literature. And so whenever you're teaching narrative literature, it's important that you understand that the way that it's built is different than, say, like a letter that Paul wrote to the Ephesians. It's different because it tells a story. That's what a narrative does. It tells a story. And within the story, there's characters. And within the characters, the movement of action, within there is theology. There's something to be found. And this is my heart, and this is what I believe, and nobody's going to convince me different, that God is a master literary artist. And listen, he writes right there on the surface. You read the text, you see what happens, and you see a resurrection miracle. Hallelujah. You see the fact that Jesus has power over sin and death. And when he speaks, things happen, and life comes to those things that were dead. Amen? But also, I'm telling you, and listen, underneath, when you start digging, you start seeing connections and you start seeing things, man. The proverb said the king desires to hide things, that God conceals things, but that is the job of the king to search out the matter, to dig for it. And you and I, as kings and priests in the kingdom of God, he desires for us to search out the matters of the scriptures and for us to be able to find these connections. Because the reason why is this. Whenever I find connections in the scriptures, they validate for me how real the word of God is and how real his plan is and how much he is concerned about the lives of his people and how he desires to get involved in our circumstances. At least that's what it does for me. And so when it comes to Bethany, what I want you to know is that this character Lazarus, he's going to be introduced to us in chapter 11. But his family, we've already learned about his family before. We learned about his family in Luke chapter 10. And in Luke chapter 10, we were introduced to his two sisters. He had two sisters. You might have remembered the story if you've read it before. He had a sister named Martha and a sister named Mary. And the Bible says in that story, in that narrative in Luke chapter 10, that Jesus had come to their house, that Martha had invited the Lord to come to their house. And it said in the scripture that Martha was real busy. She was a real hard worker, man. You can tell she was the kind of woman that cleaned and cooked and she took care of everybody's needs. And she was, man, she was getting after it, you know. And Mary, on the other hand, she's over here sitting at the feet of Jesus. She's over here like listening. She's engaged and she's just like listening to every word that comes out of the master's mouth. She's getting fed. And this is the issue. It's not a problem that Martha's a hard worker, because let me tell you something. You get a good Martha show up and you're blessed. Amen? Because Martha will work and she'll get some stuff done. Hallelujah. But the problem comes in whenever a Martha becomes cumbered about or anxious, or she allows all of the work and all of the anxiety of life and all of the things that have to get done to weigh upon her to the point where she can't sit down and enjoy the words that drip off the master's lips. And she's frustrated. Because here's Mary sitting over here enjoying the word of the Lord. She says, Lord, don't you see that I'm over here doing all this work? And look at Mary. She just said, now listening to you. And the Lord said, no, Martha, you're cumbered about with many things. You're careful about many things. That King James language for anxious. You got a lot of anxiety in your life. Mary has chosen the right thing, and it's not going to be taken from her. She's chosen the right thing because she's learned how to get a hold of me, and she's going to draw strength from me, and she's going to draw power from me. And when she does, amen, she's going to be able to learn how to work in my strength and in my power. And that's a word for every child of God. That's the first time that we're introduced to Lazarus' family, but we're not told anything about Lazarus. Now, in chapter 11 really is where our story comes from. In chapter 11 is where our story comes from. That's when we're introduced to Lazarus. In chapter 12, we're also told about Martha and Mary again. In chapter 12 of John, Martha's working again. She's serving, and here's Mary at the feet of Jesus. She said, the Bible says that Mary in chapter 12 anointed Jesus' feet for his burial. She had saved this precious ointment, this spikenard is what it was called. It was made from a flower that came from the Himalayan mountains, and it had to be transported way over there to that area in the Middle East, which was not an easy task. And the fact of the matter is, it was very expensive. And that was the story whenever Judas was sitting there and he was saying, man, this should have been saved and sold so that we could have fed the poor. And the scripture gives us a little insight into Judas's heart and says he didn't want to feed the poor. He held on to the purse and he was stealing the money. And that's really why he said what he said. But anyway, I'm just wanting you to know that in those two passages of scripture, we're introduced to the family of Lazarus, but we haven't heard anything about Lazarus. But in chapter 11, we're introduced to Lazarus. Now, we're going back to the map. And I wanted you to see that Jesus had gone from Jerusalem, where he was at the Feast of Dedication, to the other side of the Jordan, but then a message is sent from him, from Bethany, to where he is on the other side of the Jordan, from Martha and Mary. It says in John chapter 11 that it was sent unto Jesus by the sisters of Lazarus that Lazarus was sick. So a message was sent to Jesus. Hey, Lazarus is sick. We need you to come quick. We need you to come down here. And so this right here instigates a change and a movement of action in the geography, if you will, because Jesus and his disciples, they cross back over the Jordan and they come back to this area of Bethany where the little village that Lazarus and Mary and the sister Martha all live. Now, what was interesting to me was this, was that as I began to look at it, that this is how we're introduced to this character Lazarus in the story. The Word of God says that it was this man named Lazarus whose sisters were Martha and Mary, and that he was sick. And he was from this town called Bethany. But then it also interjects in verse 2 that it was that Mary, which was his sister, that anointed the Lord with ointment. This is John chapter 11, verse 2. And then this is verse 3 right here. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you lovest is sick. And the first couple of times I read that, it really didn't stick out to me. But then as I continued to ponder what's happening here, this is the message that they sent across the Jordan to go find Jesus. And this is what you got to tell him. Lord, the one that you lovest is sick. And I started thinking to myself, but doesn't Jesus love everybody? I mean, I thought that he loved all of us. I thought that we were all God's creature and that he loved us all. And certainly he does. But I'm telling you, this is one of those things that I think there's something going on here in the text that's trying to tell us that there's a bigger picture being painted here for our eyes to see. And I'm thinking to myself, this word lovest is phileo in the Greek. It's where we get our name Philadelphia, for the city of brotherly love. And it describes a fondness of affection, a closeness. So even though we've never been told about Lazarus, even in the Luke 10 narrative, which is obviously the first time that Jesus showed up, or maybe not, but nevertheless, they don't even mention Lazarus there. But what his sisters send the message to Jesus is this: the one that you love, Lord, the one that you're fond to, the one that you're connected to, the one that you care so much about, he's sick. He's sick, and if you don't show up, he's going to die. And what I began to realize was this, was that the Lord was sending us a message in the Word of God that was much more clear than just Lazarus. Don't misunderstand me. I don't want to take away from the fact that Jesus and Lazarus had a special friendship and a special closeness. I believe Lazarus loved the Lord. And I don't even want to take away from the fact that Lazarus was probably one of the most powerful miracles that we see in the Scriptures. Amen? I mean, come on, how do you get any more powerful than having power over death? When you speak and that which is dead, not just a little dead, but 4 day dead, and that which stinketh, come back to life and continues to live until his life is expired and he goes on to be with the Lord. I'm telling you, that's some powerful stuff. Yes. I don't want to take away from any of that, but at the same time, I believe that what the Lord was showing me was that Lazarus represents you. Yes. Lazarus represents me. Lazarus represents mankind born of Adam. And the message that was sent to Jesus on the other side of the Jordan is, Lord, the one that you lovest is sick. And I don't know about you, but that would be the heart cry of the preacher this morning. That would be the heart cry, or it should be, of every believer that's ever walked the face of the earth. Every human being that had any sense on the inside of his mind would recognize the condition of his own heart. And he would say, Lord, the one that you lovest is sick. And we need you to come down here. We need you to cross over. And we need you to intervene in the midst of these circumstances, or else this sickness is going to lead unto death.
Amen. Yes,
thank you. And we know what the story is. He finds himself in the midst of a dungeon, in the midst of a cave, in the midst of darkness, and in the midst of despair. And we're going to get to that in a moment. But hallelujah, Jesus makes the journey. But before we even get more further into that story a little bit and try to find the theology that's in there, I want to digress a little. What I mean by that is I want to go back and I want to talk about the overall gospel of John a little bit. And I want to try to make some connections. One of the first things that I noticed whenever I taught the gospel of John for the first time was this right here. As a matter of fact, let's go ahead and turn, if you have your Bibles, to John chapter 1. And before we start digging into this slide, I'm just going to read to you some of the things that come out of John chapter 1. Probably like the first 14 verses. It says, "In the beginning was the Word." That's a very prevalent thought within the midst of my message this morning, the concept of Word. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life." That's another very prevalent thought in the midst of my message this morning. Life. And the life was the light of men. That's another prevalent thought in my message this morning. See, I thought I was just preaching on Lazarus when I first, the Lord dropped it in my spirit. I'm going to preach on Lazarus coming out the tomb. And as I began to go, I see these recurrent themes going on. Life, the Word, darkness being dispelled, life and light. And light going on and on again, being reminded mankind needs the light of God on the inside of him so that he can have the life of God on the inside of him so that the darkness in his life can be dispelled. And it says in verse 5, "And the light shines in the darkness." There's the, and you know what the darkness is from, right? The darkness is from the fall of man. Let there be no confusion. The darkness is from the fall of man. Mankind went the way of the evil one, and now darkness has been brought upon the face of the earth, but God has a plan, amen, to bring light into the midst of darkness. And it says in verse 6, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe." So can you see that mankind is in the midst of darkness and he doesn't understand God, he doesn't know God, but yet God has a plan and he's going to reveal himself to man. And the way that he does that is he sends light in the midst of darkness. And when he shines light upon the heart of the darkened, then they're awakened and they can have the opportunity to believe. But they must first be told the truth. Amen. They must first be introduced to the truth. And the way that God introduced mankind to the truth in the beginning was he sent the light from above. Amen? Amen. It says in verse 9 that that was the true light which lights every man that comes into the world. He was in the world and the world was made by him and the world knew him not. Pay attention to that verse because we'll just mention it a little bit here when we go on this slide. He was in the world was made by him and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. See, you got to be born again. You have to be born again. Amen. Amen. There's no way about it. If you're born again, and you've truly believed from your heart that Jesus is the Christ, and that he died on the cross for your sin, and that he rose again, hallelujah, and you've been sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. How do you know? Because when the Holy Ghost lives in you, you're not the same as you used to be.
Amen.
Doesn't mean you don't make mistakes. Doesn't mean you don't mess up. But you are not the same as you used to be. You can't just keep on living that way. Come on. When the Holy Ghost shows up, he reveals truth to you, and he begins to change you on the inside.
Amen. Yes.
Hallelujah. And so when it says right here, not born of the flesh, not born of blood. That's talking about natural birth. When you came forth in water from your mother's womb, no, that was a physical birth. We're talking about being born again. Man being born of God. Man connecting himself to Jesus. Verse 14. The Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. So we're told in this passage of Scripture, listen, as a matter of fact, you know, well, let me not get ahead of myself. This is one of the things that I wanted to point out. When I first studied the Gospel of John, I began to realize that in verse 1 of John, connected to verse 1 of Genesis, really the first chapters, the closeness or you cannot convince me that the Holy Spirit, through the Apostle John, as he put his quill to the papyrus, was not having the concept of creation in mind here whenever he began to write this. In the beginning, God created. In the beginning was the Word. And even I made it, what I made was a connection with these two words, life here, because creation began physical life.
Creation began physical life whenever God reached down and he molded Adam out of the clay. That's what the Word of God says. He molded Adam out of the clay. He breathed life into Adam's lungs. He began to allow the birds of the air. He created the fish of the sea. He created the animals that would creep upon the ground. And he put life on the inside of them. But at the same time, in this narrative, what we're learning is that here on the left, we have physical creation being spoken of, physical life being spoken of, and on the right side, we're learning that even though the animals running around have blood coursing through their hearts, and they have air moving in and out of their lungs, and even though mankind has a higher cognition of intellect, and he can have a conversation with one another, and he can create all this technology, that in reality, it doesn't mean that there's life existing on the earth the way that God intended it to be. And in the John 1 narrative, what we're hearing is that God wants to send light upon the earth, and in him is the life of God. Hallelujah. And God wants it. Not only that, though, what we also learn is so that we see creation and we see life, is that we also learn that there's a common finding between word and said. Now, what we learn in John's gospel, and this was really revelation for me when I actually first picked up the Bible and began to read it after being a Christian for 12 years, was that Jesus, see, whenever you see God speaking, you may see it as though it's just God and the Word coming out of his mouth. But in reality, what John does is he gives us a commentary on creation. He tells us that the eternal Word spoke. I can't help you out in your mind to envision this, but what you need to understand is that God is a three-part being that's one in essence. All I know is this, is that whenever we see him, we're going to realize exactly what it looks like, because the Word of God says there's one seated on the throne and there's one seated at his right hand. Amen. And Jesus is the eternal Word that spoke the world into existence, but he's also the eternal Son in his relationship to the Father. The Father and the Son are one in essence, but at the same time, they're distinctly two. There's the Word and there's the Father. And John tells us in the commentary that the Word of God, hallelujah, in the beginning was the Word became flesh, the eternal Word became the flesh that dwelt amongst us, but the eternal Word is the one that spoke. He's the one that spoke and said, "Let there be light." Jesus was the light of God, and he was the light of God that came to bring light to man. And the first thing that God created to dispel the darkness was, he said, "Let there be light." Hallelujah. And the first thing he does in John is he says, "Let the light of God come from heaven and let it bring light unto men in the midst of their spiritual darkness." And so also what I want you to see once again is it talks about light. And once again, we see that the light is connected between the two. Right. And then also we see the common theme of darkness. And I just wanted you to see how this goes on and on and on. Within this first chapter, it's setting a theme for us for the whole Gospel of John. That God has a plan, and within this first chapter of Gospel of John, we see the plan of God that's explaining to us that man's condition in the midst of darkness, he needs intervention, amen, and God gives life and he brings light. All right. And so in the chapter before our story, now this is another Bible study technique. How many people, you don't have to raise your hand, but I'm going to ask the question. How many people read your Bibles, right? And some of you raising your hand anyway, amen. Praise God, I'm glad you read your Bibles. So if you read your Bibles and you get to a part in a chapter where you say, you know what, I don't know if I completely understand that. Hopefully you're not like I used to be, man. I'd sit there and I'd just read. And I'm reading. I got three chapters down today. But I don't know that I really took the time to know whether or not I was comprehending anything, whether I was thinking about it. You understand what I'm saying? You want to contemplate what you're reading. You want to think about it. Take your time and get something out of it. Let it speak. Amen? And sometimes whenever you get to a certain spot in the scripture, you feel as though you don't really understand maybe what's going on. One good Bible study technique or rule is you go to the chapter before it and you read that. You go to the chapter after it and you read that. Because it's amazing sometimes how you'll find connections, and you might be able to find a common theme that's going on. And if you can find that common theme, then maybe you're getting a little bit closer to the real message that God's trying to speak. Amen? Well, one of the things that I did was I went back to chapter 10. And I started looking at some common things that I felt like were parallel or congruent or in agreement with what we just talked about in John chapter 1. And then I was wondering, is there some kind of way that all these things can also connect to the Lazarus story? And so anyway, we'll see as we go through. But in John chapter 10, verse 10, you see right here what it says. The thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and to destroy. But I have come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. So we see once again the common theme of life. And we see once again that the thief came to steal. He came to steal, he came to kill, he came to destroy. And we see in the beginning, as soon as creation is completed, the enemy comes in and he brings a lie. And the lie causes death, it causes untold sorrow, it causes darkness to be dispelled. That the life of God is now, mankind is now separated from the life of God. He now finds himself in isolation on the outside of the garden. You remember the story, we've talked about that multiple times. For those of you maybe that haven't been around as much, whenever God expelled them out of the garden, if you'll remember what he did was, he put two cherubim at the outside of the gate with flaming swords, and flames represent judgment, and the cherubim were these special types of angels, and basically God was guarding the entranceway back into the garden where his presence was dwelling, and now mankind finds himself on the outside, incapable and not able to get back into the presence of God. So that's what the enemy's come to do. He's come to steal and kill and destroy. And much of what he wants to try to steal from you is your access to the presence of God. And so, but Jesus has come to bring life. And so we see this. And this is what he says. He says, I'm the good shepherd. And the shepherd gives his life for the sheep. See, that's one of the things that why you can never move away from the cross. There's been a lot of heretical teachings that have taken place in the modern church. A lot of heretical teachings that have taken place in really the Word of Faith movement. Well, you know, some people say that you shouldn't say certain things, but let me just say this. I read this with my own eyes. I researched it more than once. I went back to the original source more than once. So I feel confident enough that that sometimes whenever things are found that way, that you should point things out. And Kenneth Hagin made this comment. He said the cross was the greatest defeat in human history, and that we should move past the cross, and that we should move forward to the resurrection. But this is the problem. You can't have the power of resurrection without the cross.
Amen.
You can't have a new man resurrected in Christ till an old man dies in him.
Amen.
And you cannot separate the two, because resurrection power is connected to the power of Calvary. The Word of God says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, the preaching of the cross is foolishness to them who perish, but unto us who are saved, it is. What is? What is it? What is it? What is it connected to? It's an antecedent. It's connected back to the subject, which is the cross. It is. What is the message of the cross? The word of the cross is the power of God, because that is how God has showed, has determined to reveal himself to lost man. And that is what this passage is talking about. That if you want to have life, the word of God saying in John chapter 1, that in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and that the word came down and he dwelt with man, and that the word brought life into man, and he came to dispel the darkness. Well, how in the world, Lord, are you going to cause life to come into man when he finds himself in the midst of darkness? That's how.
That's it.
Because he's the good shepherd. And he lays down his life for the sheep. It's an exchange that takes place. Don't tell me that sin's not a problem. Don't tell me that you can just sweep it under the rug, when the reality of it is that God had to send his only begotten son, the sinless one, who all he ever did was obey the Father. Oh, I wish I could say it. I wish I could say, oh, Father, I've been such a good Christian for you. Ever since you touched my heart, I just get it right all the time. You know, I wasn't dependent on you, Matt. I was dependent on my son. I was dependent on his plan. Ballard didn't get it all right this week, amen? Everybody in this room, many of us failed the Lord this week. But hallelujah, Jesus never failed the Lord. And he rested all of the plan upon Jesus. And there was an exchange that took place.
Amen.
If you're going to have life on this earth, I'm not talking about breathing in 26% O2. I'm not talking about just breathing oxygen into your lungs. I'm talking about living for God. I'm talking about the life of God on the inside of you. Amen. Then you're going to have to accept this exchange.
Amen.
You're going to have to go to the Good Shepherd. You're going to have to ask him, Lord, give me your through Jesus Christ our Lord. I want to make that clear. You're not going to get past the cross. And if you do, you listen, it's heresy. Now, did the people preach it on purpose? That's between them and Jesus. I don't know. I'm not trying to say that they're purposefully saying the wrong thing. I don't purposely say the wrong thing when I do. You understand that? I don't get it right all the time. I know that. I'm a human being. Another one said, Kenneth Copeland, I saw this on his website. I went back to it 3-4 times before I ever told anybody. And then now they took it off. But they never recanted the statement. It said, when his blood poured out, it did not atone. Taking it away from the finished work of Christ. He had other reasonings why and other things that had to be done. And that whenever Jesus said it is finished, he wasn't talking about the giving of his life. But that there was more that had to be done. Specifically talking about the fact that Jesus died spiritually and had to go down into hell and speak the word over the devil, which is not even in the scriptures. Nevertheless, I'm just trying to tell you, don't go try to think you can go past the cross. Okay. Don't think you can go past. I'm not telling you something that I just heard somebody saying, so I'm spewing out a bunch of stuff. I'm telling you stuff that I went back and I researched for myself on more than one occasion. Amen. And I'm trying to tell you, you got to hold on to what the gospel says. We got to get into the truth of what the word of God says. And we need to hold on to Amen. That. Because people are going to be deceived in the end days. Mm-hmm. Yes. Amen. It says right here, as the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. When I saw that, I was like, remembering in the beginning was the word, and I was remembering, and God said, let there be light. And here in this scripture, here what stuck out to me, they shall hear my voice, the sound of the voice of Jesus, the sound of the word of God. Whenever it's spoken, when the word of God is spoken, creation takes place. Whether it's creation in the physical or whether it's creation in the spiritual, that in the same plan that God the Father has of salvation, when the word of God is spoken, the Holy Spirit hovers over the heart of man just as he hovered over the deep whenever the earth was without form and void. And when the word was spoken, the Holy Spirit enacted it. And when the word was spoken over your heart and you took your faith and you put it in Christ, you did do that, didn't you? I just want to make sure you did that. I'm not talking about, oh, but I grew up in the church, preacher. I grew up in the church, and mommy and daddy brought me to Sunday school all my life. That doesn't mean anything to the Lord. What matters to the Lord is, did you take your heart? And did you believe with your heartfelt faith that Jesus Christ was the answer, that he died on the cross, and then you believe that an exchange took place, and that when you put your faith in Christ, the old you that was born of Adam, that was born in darkness, now finds himself in Christ inside of a tomb, buried with Jesus, and then hallelujah, on the third day, in the mind of God, a new man was resurrected in Christ. If you believe from your heart, I'm here to tell you that's what happened to you in the spiritual realm. The Lord changed you, hallelujah. He delivered you. He gave you new life. But if you haven't put your faith in that, and you've just been going through with an intellectual understanding, oh yeah, I believe Jesus is the one. Listen to me. I use this all the time. Got it from Brother Larson. Intellectual understanding doesn't do the trick. There's a lot of people that believe that 2,000 years ago, a 33-year-old Jewish man died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem. A lot of people believe that. The recent Gallup poll that I read, 85% of Americans say that they believe that. But there's no change in their life. Nothing at all has happened at all. They say that they're Christian, but they don't. I mean, and listen, going to church isn't what makes you a Christian. Don't misunderstand me. But you would think that if the life of God was living in you, you would want to hear more about the life of God and what it can do for you.
Amen.
So even if you're not going to church, you should at least be reading your Bible, right? You should at least be trying to learn about Jesus some kind of way. There should be something happening on the inside of you. I'm talking about the voice of God. I'm talking about the word of God. I'm talking about the sound of God reverberating through the air and reaching into the heart of man. And when man hears it in his heart and he responds by faith, a miracle happens.
Amen.
That which is dead and in darkness comes to life. The light of God becomes resident on the inside of you. And when it does, things change. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And a process can begin. A a process of renovation, a process of change. I know I use this analogy a lot. I learned it from Brother Larson too a long time ago about 9/11. You know, sometimes we think we're more holy than what we really are, and God has to orchestrate some circumstances in our lives to reveal to us, you're not quite what you thought you were, son.
Yeah.
And the fact of the matter is that many times there's things in our life, and Christianity is not only an event. When you first really put your faith in Christ, you were sealed with the Holy Ghost, but it's also a process. Now that the life of God and the light of God is on the inside of you, He brings you through a cleansing process, through a teaching process, and He's beginning to mold you, and He's taking things out of you. And just like 9/11 with those big old huge heaps of rubble that looked like it was an insurmountable task, there were little trucks at the bottom of the screen that were moving in and moving out. And on a daily basis, the Holy Spirit's moving in and moving out. He's taking things. He's revealing things. He's pulling things out. And it's a little bit at a time. And you and I both got to learn how to be patient with one another as God does His work. We need to let the Holy Ghost do His work in each and every one of our lives. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. But we got to hear His voice. We got to be able to hear the Word of God and got to respond to it. Yeah, he says again, therefore, this is all out of chapter 10, the preceding chapter of where we are. Therefore, does my Father love me because I lay down my life that I might take it again? Surely there's a spiritual truth in there for each and every one of us. Amen. How much we try to hold on to and cling to our life, to want things the way that we want them. I'm just preaching to you what I think that the Lord is saying here. He says, therefore, doth my Father love me. Because I laid down my life. Now, there's much bigger meaning in Him laying down His life than there is for you and I to lay down our life. Because His laying down of life gives life unto us. But not only that He might take it again. So through death comes life. As a matter of fact, it's the same thing. He says, no man takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. This is talking about resurrection power.
Yes.
And you see, the thing of it is that why this was sticking out to me so much is because now we're going to transition from chapter 10, where Jesus is saying all of these things. I've come to bring life. I will lay down my life. And that I'm the good shepherd, and they're going to hear my voice. And it's going to result in the fact that they're going to be given life. And I'm going to lay down my life. And it's going to result in resurrection life. And in the next chapter, when we get to Lazarus, I can't even think of the word. The teacher would be able to tell me, come on somebody, help me out, an illustrated sermon of everything that he just preached in chapter 10. He's going to illustrate it. The one that you love, Lord, he's sick. And if you don't show up fast, he's going to die. And now we find mankind dead in the next chapter. He's dead and he's alone and he's separated from the life of God. But Jesus has resurrection power. This is another interesting thing to me. Now, you see, on the surface, you're not going to find it. But when I read it, I said, you can't just pass that up. You don't even know it for sure. You probably studied in the past, but you don't even remember. What's a feast of dedication? What does that even mean? You got to know what you're talking about, preacher. So I had to go do some research. Feast of dedication. Also known as the Feast of Lights. Isn't that interesting? Also known as the Feast of Lights or Hanukkah. So we have within chapter 10 the same thing that we had in chapter 1, life, light, voice, sound, word. Amen. So let's talk a little bit about the Feast of Lights. Also known as Hanukkah. Feast of Dedication. Well, if you've been studying with us in the Revelation series, one of the things that we talked about was the Daniel 9 prophecy. Y'all remember that? You should. We talked about it for about 4 weeks. In the Daniel 9 prophecy, I told you that something happened during the time frame that Daniel foretold was going to take place, where he prophesied that there was going to be an abomination that causes desolation. And what that happened was that Alexander the Great, so before, whenever Daniel prophesies, Babylon has already taken captive of Israel. Judah, the lower portion. And Persia, there's been a shift in world powers. Persia has taken over Babylon. And so Daniel is prophesying during the time frame of Persian rule. And he prophesies of two other future kingdoms. One is Alexander the Great's kingdom, and then the next one is Rome. And so what he prophesies about Alexander the Great's kingdom is that during that little horn, which represents the Greek dynasty, that there was going to be an abomination that causes desolation. Now, the interesting thing is that during that time frame, after Alexander the Great died, four of his kingdom was split into four generals. We talked about this at length whenever we talked about it. And one of those generals was a man named Antiochus Epiphanes, or at least he took over a certain section that the land was split up, which entailed Israel. And during that time frame, Antiochus Epiphanes came in and he made some changes. First off, he said they couldn't circumcise their male boys anymore, which was the sign of their covenant. He said they couldn't follow after the things of the Lord. And then he took a pig and he slit it open and he put it on the altar. He desecrated the altar because, see, a swine was considered unclean. It was an unclean animal. And because of that, it caused something called the Maccabean Revolt. So if you read, and you notice in the Catholic Bible, there's other books, and one of them is called 1st and 2nd Maccabees. It's a historical book about this occurrence that took place. And in there, there was a Maccabean revolt, and what happened was that during the time frame of the Maccabees, for a short period of time, in that intertestamental period between Malachi and Matthew, which was 400 years, during that time frame, for a short period of time, Israel regained dominion of the city, and they reconsecrated the temple, but more importantly, they reestablished the altar. And when they did that, they started to celebrate this feast of dedication. And so we're talking about 400 years later that Jesus is actually in Jerusalem whenever they're doing it. And the way that they did it was they would light all of these lights, and they would put the lights on the inside of their houses and all of the, you know, to represent that the light of God was with them, because you understand that the light of God traveled with Israel and was with them because of the temple, more specifically because of the Ark of the Covenant, more specifically because of the blood that was on top of the mercy seat, where God said he would dwell with his people, and he said that the glory of God would be with them. Some people call it the Shekinah glory, which there was just a light, they say, that would emanate from there. Once again, light. The light of God was with Israel, but it all had to do with the altar, because without a sacrifice, the presence of God cannot dwell with his people. And so I just thought it was interesting that in the midst of chapter 10, we also see the concept of light, and I just thought I would throw that out there for you. So we're seeing repeated themes in this chapter: life, word, and light. He lays down his life, he picks up his life. His sheep hear his voice, going back to the word, and light, the feast of dedication, also known as the feast of lights. And so here, this is actually a picture. I don't know how well you can see it. It looks like a cartoon with my bad eyes. But anyway, it's actually a picture, and this is supposed to be the traditional spot of Lazarus' tomb. And I just wanted to show you a picture of that. But here's this artist's rendition of Lazarus, and I'm just thinking to myself, mankind, born of Adam, finds himself in a spiritual condition. He's separated from the presence of God. Just imagine yourself if you were physically alive and you were sitting in this tomb where Lazarus is. Lazarus is in this tomb, and let's just pretend that you're in there with him, and you're alive, and you're breathing. You're breathing the O2, and your body's functioning. But the reality of it is that there's a stone that stands in the way of the opening of this cave, and there's no light in there. It's only darkness. And not only that, there's not really any sound coming from the outside. You can't really hear anything. As a matter of fact, if you hear anything, it's real muffled. Barely can you hear the words that are being spoken on the outside. I mean, the truth of the matter is that everybody's weeping. If you go back and you read the story, Martha ran out to find Jesus. Mary, when she sees him, she just collapses at his feet, wailing. Lord, if you would have been here a little bit sooner than the one that you love, he wouldn't have had to die. But see, truthfully, much of this miracle is all in preparation also for them to be prepared about what's about to go down. What's about to go down? Jesus is about to go to Jerusalem. He's about to die on a cross. And on the third day, he's going to raise again. And then people aren't going to believe it. How do you know that, preacher? Because the Lord told us in Luke chapter 16, when there was another Lazarus. Remember that? It's not the same Lazarus. He was a beggar, a poor beggar at the side. It said he was so poor that the dogs would come and lick his sores. And that he died and a rich man died. And they both ended up in the other part of the other realm that we don't see. Now, this was before Jesus went to the cross. And in that situation, there was a place called Abraham's bosom before Jesus went to the cross. That place isn't there anymore. The Word of God says, now to be absent with from the body is to be present with the Lord. Today is the day of salvation. It's appointed unto the man wants to die, then the judgment. There's no in-between. There's no limbo. During that time frame, before the cross, there was a place called Abraham's bosom. It says Lazarus went there, and there was a rich man, and he went to a place called torment. And he said, he could see Abraham across the gulf, and he said, Father Abraham, won't you just dip your finger in some water and touch it to my tongue? I'm so thirsty. He said, we can't get over there. There's a gulf that's fixed between us. I can't get to you. You can't get to me. He said, well, won't you please send somebody to tell my father and my brothers about this situation? They need to hear because this is not good. Please, won't you send somebody to tell them? He said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them read them. In other words, oh, that's so good. I'm getting revelation as I'm thinking. I've been sitting here trying to talk to people about Jesus, and they're like, you want me to believe just like that doctor I was telling you about at the health club a couple of weeks back? You want me to believe based off of just a book that's written? No. I said, I know what you need, sir. You need to apply the scientific method to your theology. It doesn't work that way, sir. God created, and he said you're going to have faith. And this is what he gave you, communication in a book. And if you're not willing to read it and believe it, I'm sorry, but that's a problem, because God has gone through the process of thousands of years of human history to prepare this book so that mankind would be able to read it and apply his faith to believe that it's true, and if he would just do a simple thing like that. Come on, hardhead. I'm talking to the preacher. All you got to do is believe what God has said, and he will do a miracle in your heart and in your life, and he will reveal himself to you.
Amen.
And I'm thinking, as I'm telling you about that parable, that Father Abraham said, no, I'm not going to send a special messenger. They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear Moses and the prophets. Oh, no, but if somebody that come back from the dead would tell them, then they would believe. He said, no, they won't. They won't even believe, even if somebody comes back from the dead. Jesus was telling the story that happened. I believe that happened in those places and that he was the only one that knew about it. But it was written on the pages so that you and I would know that it happened. And what he was talking about was, no, they won't. They won't believe even if one comes back from the dead. I'm here to tell you that it's still going to happen because I'm going to come back from the dead. I'm going to break the power of sin. I'm going to get power over death, hell, and the grave. And I'm going to resurrect on the third day. And even then, they're still not going to believe.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Let them believe Moses and the prophets. But here Lazarus is, we're back in the situation, and you can put yourself in there with him, and the stone is on the face of the cave, and there's muffled sound on the outside because everybody is in so much pain, and they're groaning, and they're weeping, and the Word of God says that Jesus even wept, but yet you can't hear. You can't hear clearly because there's a stone in the way. And I was just thinking about the fact that on the inside of this darkness, there's darkness, there's a muffled sound, and there's death. And I was thinking about the common theme that we've been talking about, right? Chapter 1, chapter 10, life, light, word, voice. Jesus speaking and things changing. Jesus showing up and speaking and darkness being changed into light. Death being changed into life. Hallelujah. You got to be able to hear. You got to be able to hear the Word of God. You got to be able to experience the Word in order to respond to it.
Amen.
So the first thing that I was thinking about here was this, is that take ye the stone away. That's the first thing Jesus said. He said, where did they lay him? And he goes over there and he says, take the stone away. And I was thinking, man, this stone represents anything that stands in the way of the face of this cave that prevents the word and the light from getting into where it needs to get into in order to cause a change on the inside of your life. It can represent sin, and it can also represent religion. Well, what are you talking about? Well, let's go ahead and turn to a couple of scriptures. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, starting at verse 3. Paul says, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. So to the person that's lost, I hate to say it, but to that doctor that I'm not trying to pick on you, sir. I doubt you know about our videos, but I'm not trying to pick on anybody. I'm trying to make a point. If you're lost and you try to tell somebody about the word, if they don't allow the stone to roll away, the gospel remains hidden to them. It's like blinders on, or scales on their eyes. I don't care how intellectual you are. I don't care how scientific you are. I don't care if you know molecular cell biology and you understand the Krebs cycle better than anybody in the house. It doesn't matter if you understand the basic elements of how physical life works. If you refuse to allow the stone to be rolled away, the gospel will be hidden to you. Yeah. And if you're not careful, Christian, and you allow sin to stay in your life, the gospel will become hid to you. There's a stone that tries to stand in the doorway of the cave, and it wants to prevent the allowance of light on the inside, and it wants to muffle the sound of the voice of God to reach in on the inside to be able to change circumstances and things on the inside of your life. It says in verse 4, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Now, he's not talking about, right there, you know who he's talking about, the God of this world? He's talking about the prince of darkness. The Apostle Paul said it right there. The God of this world, by default, through Adam's disobedience, relinquishing power to the evil one. That doesn't mean that he's in control. Oh, no. The God we serve is sovereign. He's in control. He's about to wrap this thing up. I believe it with all my heart. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, you need to understand the God of this world blinds people's eyes. He's blinding the eyes of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So this stone is standing in the way of Lazarus's miracle. He's on the inside of the tomb. He's on the inside, and there's death and there's darkness and there's only a muffled sound. You got to roll that stone away. You got to respond to the gospel, Christian. You got to respond to the gospel, sinner. You got to let the stone be rolled away so that the word of God can penetrate and cause and to be able to do what it is that it desires to do on the inside of your heart. Roll the stone away. Religion says right here in 2 Corinthians 3. Starting in verse 11, for that which is done away was glorious. It's talking about the Old Testament law. That's what Paul's talking about. That which was done away was glorious, much more that which remains is glorious. The New Testament, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Seeing then that we have such a hope, we use great plainness of speech. In other words, we're not going to talk about the temple articles and how they represent Jesus. Instead, we're just going to tell you about Jesus. Now, it's not that we don't teach about all those things, because we do. Paul's trying to explain to them all those things of those types and shadows that were pointing us to Jesus have been fulfilled in him. So we're going to just speak plainly and tell you about Jesus. He says, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. In other words, he actually put the veil on his face to hide the fact that the glory was waning away, just as the Old Testament was waning away. That's what it's saying right there. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remains the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. If you refuse, see, religion will do this to you. I'm not just talking about Mosaic law. If you're following after religion and you refuse to let the stone be rolled away to where you realize that, yes, Jesus is the only way, that you must forsake religion. Religion will stand in the mouth of the cave and prevent light from entering in and cause a muffled voice, a muffled sound to where you cannot hear the truth of the gospel the way that you should. And instead, there's a veil that remains over the eyes and prevents you from being able to see properly the gospel, which will set you at liberty. Listen, churches are filled with people with a spirit of religion. Come on. Y'all know, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of you that's been in the church for any length of time, you know what I'm talking about. People got a spirit of religion. They think they know everything. Lord, help me, because I sure don't want one of them things. You think you know everything, and you can't be taught anything. Lord, please. I don't want to be like that. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be blinded by a spirit of religion. So there's a veil that remains on their heart. Verse 60, nevertheless, when they shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So I just want you to know, this stone can represent anything that stands in the way of the Word of God entering in, of the light of God entering in, and I just use sin and religion to describe those two things. And so here we go to the next one. And then she says, but Lord, he stinketh. He's been dead for 4 days. And I started thinking to myself, well, that's the point. That's what the Lord's coming for. The truth of the matter is that he wants the old life to stink. The Lord, he waited. As a matter of fact, if you go back and you read the story, the conclusion that you'll come to is, Lord, the one that you love is sick. And the Bible says that Jesus tarried there 2 more days. Right. He purposely waited 2 more days so that by the time he got there, Lazarus would be 4 days dead. Many times we're crying out to the Lord to show up in the midst of our circumstances and we're saying, hey, Lord, help me, deliver me. I need you to do a work on the inside of me. And the Lord's like, I'm going to tarry just 2 more days because I'm waiting for this thing to be 4 days dead in the midst of your life. I'm waiting for this thing to start stinking in the midst of your life. You think you're ready for me to take it away, but the reality of it is that you're just not quite ready yet. It doesn't stink yet in your life. So we're going to let it linger around a little bit longer. But when you cry out on that time, when you're really sick and tired of it and you're really ready for me to bring deliverance, hallelujah, on that day, when you're crying out, I'm going to be right there with you because I'll never leave you or forsake you. And I'm going to show up and I'm going to speak to this situation. And that which was dead is going to come to life. He said, oh, he stinketh. That's what the Word of God says in Romans 6:6-7. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is free from sin. God wants that old man to die in Christ. Yes. Mm-hmm. And he wants, in this process of Christianity, listen, we talked about it a while back, there's Jordan still to cross on the other side. There's Jericho still to fall. Yes. There's still going to be strongholds. God left the giants in the land on the other side. This thing is, there's still a battle. But every battle is won the same way. Faith in Christ and what he did gives us power over the forces of evil. Period. The problem that we run into is that oftentimes we don't believe it yet. We either, number one, we don't believe what the Word of God is saying in order to believe that God can set the captive free. Or number two, it just ain't 4 days dead yet. You understand what I'm saying? It don't stink yet. I still like, you ain't gonna play around with something that stinks. You understand? Lazarus been in the tomb for 4 days. Lazarus has been in the tomb for 4 days. Nobody wants to unroll that stone away. Nobody wants to go hang out in there with dead Lazarus because he doesn't smell good. And as long as the thing that you're fondling and you're holding on to smells good and you refuse to allow and see what it is, then guess what? It ain't 4 days dead. And you can say that you want the Lord to do this, that, and the other thing, but the fact of the matter is until it's 4 days dead, that's whenever the Lord's going to tarry. He's just going to wait 2 more days. But when you start crying out to him and you say, no, Lord, I want you to do this in my life, and you mean business with him, I'm telling you right now, he's not going to leave you forsaken. He's going to speak a word, and a miracle is going to happen. It says right there, he cried with a loud voice. He cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth, and he that was dead came forth. You know, I started to just think about, once again, the Word. The Word became flesh. The Word spoke. The Word brought life. The stone had to be rolled away. Jesus cried with a loud voice. I read one commentator. He said, it's a good thing that he said Lazarus come forth, because had he not delineated who he wanted to come forth, everybody dead in every tomb in the surrounding area that heard his voice, they would have all come popping out. They would have been beating on those stones over that cave. Hey, let us out of here, because in his voice is life. His word is life, hallelujah. And when he speaks, dead things live. And that's what happened. Jesus cried with a loud voice. He said, Lazarus, come forth. And it says, he that was dead came forth. The Word of God says in Philippians 3:10, that I might know him. Do you know him, Christian? Mm-hmm. I didn't ask you whether or not you got it all right this week. I'm asking you, do you know him? I'm not asking you whether or not you went to Sunday school when you were a little girl. I'm asking you, do you know him? Did you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior? Did you invite him into your heart? Did you feel your belly get warm? Did you feel, I'm not talking about real heat. I'm talking about just the sealing of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit showing up in your life. Amen. Changing the way you think. Giving you a desire to want to move forward with him and to forsake the old life. Did you get born again? Do you know him? Hallelujah. I got born again a long time ago, and I'll tell you, I thought I knew him. I know I'm a whole lot better today than I did on that day, but I still got some more knowing to do. Amen?
Amen.
That I might know him and the power of his resurrection. Lazarus got a taste of the power of his resurrection. Amen? And the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. If you want to experience resurrection power of Jesus, you're going to have to become conformable unto his death. That's talking about the old man out of Romans 6 dying with Christ again. The old man dying in Christ. Hallelujah. Sin. You no longer have to serve sin. It's not your master. It's not your Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. But the power of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit that flows into you because of your faith in the finished work of Christ gives you strength and grace in order to live for God. You just got to want it. Amen.
Amen.
Then it says he came forth and he was bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Let me ask you something. How in the world, now this is part of the process of Christianity, but how in the world are you going to be able to work or walk for God whenever your hands and your feet are bound by grave clothes? How are you going to be able to see spiritually whenever you got a napkin hanging over the front of your face? You know, you understand what I'm trying to say? Yes, we're talking about a physical death turning into a physical life. But the fact of the matter is that after a man and woman is born again, the grave tries to cling to them. The old life tries to cling to them and tries to leave them in bondage and bind them up and prevent their hands from being able to do the work of God, prevent their feet from being able to stay upon the narrow path and cause their eyes to be blinded by the things of the God of this world. But hallelujah, the Word of God says in Ephesians 4:22 that you put off concerning your former conversation. What does that mean? Your old lifestyle. That's an old King James word, conversation for lifestyle. You put him off. It's like an old garment. You used to be clothed with this. You were born of Adam. When you were born of Adam, you were already born clothed with a garment. A garment of an old man, born in sin. It clings to you. See, when you get born again and you come out the grave, I'm telling you right now, you just wish that this thing would fall off. But it wants to cling to you. It wants to hang around with you. It wants to tell you that you're guilty. It wants to tell you that you're a sinner. But the fact of the matter is I got to tell you that an exchange took place on the cross. And the Word of God says in Ephesians 4:22, and if you keep on reading, it says that you put off the old man. Put off concerning the former conversation, the old man. Who's the old man? That which was born of Adam. You put him off. And really in the Greek, that's what the idea is. It's like it's a garment. You take it off and you throw it to the side. And that you put on the new man. That's what the next verse says. You put on the new man that's created in Christ. You need to understand that an exchange took place at the cross. I need to understand that an exchange took place at the cross. He took my guilt upon him, and he put his righteousness upon me. And if I will learn how to believe that, because listen to me, I got people all the time that, and I'm not talking about a license to sin, because we go too far the other way. Think I can just live any old way I want to and it's all good. No, no, that's not how it works. But the fact of the matter is, at the same time, when you make a mistake during the week, or whenever you fall, you got to remember something. Jesus, hallelujah, loves you, and he allowed an exchange to take place, and it's not built upon your performance. It's built upon the performance of the righteous one, the obedient one, who never failed, and an exchange took place. Don't let the grave clothes bind you up. Hallelujah. Don't let them shackle your hands. Don't let it shackle your feet. Don't let that napkin of the grave cover your eyes. The Lord said, come forth, you who are dead. And then the next thing he saw was this. He said, loose him and let him go. And that was the title of my message. The Lord said, loose him. In other words, take those grave clothes off. And what Jesus did to save you so that you can go to heaven is the same thing he did to set you free. Those grave clothes can't bind you anymore. That napkin can't blind you anymore. Hallelujah. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. Be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if you be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. He's talking about religion again. He's talking about law right there. That's the context. Don't go back to old religion. Don't go back to the old way of thinking. At the same time, don't go back to your old way of living. Don't let a yoke entangle you again.